The Orient was producing porcelain during the time of Marco Polo. And he named it porcelain after the seashells in Portugal, which are called porcelana. So the Orient had a big step ahead in that respect. And their master potters were far more experienced than those in the West. And they were imported to other countries, and Japanese potters were brought to France, and the West gradually learned. And I'm a result of a Japanese potter named Hamada, who came to this country in the 50s. There are books on pottery, but they're not very good. As you can see, there's so many visual things that are happening in motion that even a photographic portrayal doesn't work. The only way I found that you can teach without actually having a potter there to help you is what he's doing right now, the videotape. The videotape is really good because when a child is working on a problem and is having trouble with it, that's the time he really needs the help. And that's when he's watching me now, and he says, ooh, ooh, and on, and it's great. But he's not absorbing all that. He can't. When he's in trouble and he really wants to know, then he'll look at that and he'll see things in there that he didn't see ordinarily. So if it's possible for him to go over to a video machine when he's in trouble and put a tape on and look at how a potter trims a pot, he will begin to see what he's doing wrong. And it's a fantastic learning medium. I think Luke had it. It goes right on the thing without thinking. Then you say, hey, that was pretty good. Try it again. Oh, no, not the second time. Well, the same thing is true of making these lids. When I do them without thinking, as I do in my shop, one after another, I just make them and they're the right size. This morning it was very lucky because I made a teapot with a strainer and everything, and no one asked me how I was going to make it the right size before it was all done. Then I explained it to them. And that way, the thing came out exactly right. I hope this one does too. I tried not to think about it. Yes, it's exactly the right size. Now, I had to make... What was that? And it does. It's a different kind of intelligence. But there's an interrelationship there. And an autistic student isn't a dumb student who becomes interested in art because he can't do anything else. He's an intelligent student. He's intelligent in a different way, in a more tactual way perhaps, or maybe he's even intelligent in every way, but he found those other ways blocked to him. I don't really know how to quite explain it, but when you finish making something with clay, whether it's good or bad, it stands there as a concrete object that you can look at. When you answer a question right or do a math problem, it's so abstract that some children find that it lacks the kind of satisfaction that they need emotionally. Also, there are people who can get involved with a verbal problem, a test, or other things, in such a way that they totally lose themselves in that problem. And there are other people who can only do that when working with a concrete medium, such as finger paints, or watercolors, or clay, or something like that. So many of the people indulge in sports because sports is one thing which, while they're doing it, they lose themselves. And this losing of oneself is a very important health function to the mind. If one goes through life never being able to lose himself, he is like someone who has never had a good night's sleep, to make that kind of relationship. A good night's sleep is very important to the normal health of people. And total involvement is also very important to the health of one person, to feel that what you're doing takes over your whole body and your whole mind. Most of you, how many here teach children, real young children? Well, you've seen it over and over again how very young children, at that stage they haven't been corrupted, they can paint or draw and they're gone. I mean, if they're painting a lion, they're a lion. You know, if they're, whatever they're doing, they are into it. And it's very sad to see that disappear as people grow older, and that they end up always being held back, not ever giving all of themselves. I was very happy to see that in the brushwork classes I gave here, there was occasionally I could look over and see a face, and I saw a couple of faces on a television replay, videotape replay, of high school kids who were like little kids, again being lost and doing what they're doing. And that is so healthy and good. Now this is just a basic shape. It could be a cookie jar or anything. And a sculpted pot is a pot in which you make form leave the surface practically, like this pot is here. No clay was added on that or cut away. It was just pushed out of the walls and distorted. And it's hard to do the complete pot for you because the clay is too soft. I will begin to distort it and rough it out, and then I can show you on another pot how I refine that. But you can pinch like that. You can push out and roll your hands around a form. You can roll it like this. You can do all sorts of things to make the form leave the surface. Well, you got to be careful not to stretch it too far. No, the clay has a lot of flexibility to it, provided you give it time to stretch. You know, it'll move. Just the basic form. I would have to work over this a lot later. Sometimes I leave it like this, but most of the time I just find this as a means of getting the clay started, and I would finish it later. This lid is supposed to be for this pot here. Wet to leave it on there. And this is designed after an ancient biblical bottle, which you hold like this and you pour. When you pour, the air can get in the rear so that this stream is smooth and clear, doesn't gurgle and doesn't drip when you stop. They used to drink out of them like this, see, and they carried them on their camels.
Bag or something.
Yes, it's like that. And this clay, the speckle and all the color in this comes from black sand that I get on the beach. On the Cape. If you've ever been out after a storm, you'll notice that there are areas where there's streaks of black sand. Well, that is distributed there by the wind, because the wind blows the light sand away and leaves the black sand accumulated in a slight slope. I skim it up with a shovel and I add it to my white clay. There you can see the speckle. But when the glaze is fired on it, the iron in that mixes with the glaze, and this flecking is completely caused by the glaze. I'll pass one of these goblets around. You can look at the sand speckle in it.
You mean there's not a brown, there's not a color?
There's no color, that's a clear white glaze. All the color comes from the sand.
when you work on a wheel, there's something very demanding about centering. It takes strength, but it also takes feel. When the clay is just right in the center, you can feel it. And it's not something you can explain. And the same thing is true in life. If you have your life centered around something that you are especially talented to do, and you found that thing, then your life is centered around that. And everything else relates to that. When you shape the piece of clay, before you can make any individual bowls or vases or other shape, you have to have the mass of clay centered. And you have to center your energy and your life first before you can have things grow out of it. Works of art, children, whatever. I always have this feeling that dreams, as well as fantasizing, are just as much a part of your real life as real life of what happens every day. They make up your character. After all, after you have an experience, it becomes a memory, and there's no difference between that memory and the memory of any dream. When your mind becomes saturated with a problem, you can't resolve it. Something's wrong, and it doesn't work. It's as though you're going into the library and you can't find the right book. So you forget about it, you put it out of your mind. But the mind, as a separate part of you, can operate on its own. It can go through those stacks, taking out miscellaneous books, and might just by accident, almost, pull out the answer. Once you let go and stop thinking about it.
I'm glad I changed this arm because the gesture of the figure now makes much more sense. This was too contorted and stretched. It was reaching out too far. The one I did before this, I had a figure. I left it on a stand and I sprayed it and got too wet. And while I was away, the thing leaned, fell on the floor and I lost 2 weeks' work. But it's nothing lost because I had the experience of having done it. So it doesn't make you feel bad at all. I went into another one. This is the very first pot I ever made, and it was fired. First one I carried out all the way to a finish. Guess who made that? Picasso.
don't know if you can pick this up, the light is pretty bad, but this is dated 1935 by a man named Grunewald. When I lived in the Bronx and I was just a kid, let's see, how old was I? This is 35. I was 13 years old. I didn't know anybody who was an artist. I had no connection with the art world. And to have somebody living in our house, who was a boarder in our house, who painted every evening, it intrigued me because I wanted to do it. I used to stand outside his room and he'd let the door open a crack. And I'd watch him for hours, just wouldn't say a word. And I thought he didn't know I was watching, but he knew. And then on my birthday, he gave me this painting and he gave me a set to work with. That started me off.
He was a big influence on Harry. I would say he was the biggest influence because he learned to draw from him and he learned to paint. And he used to, this man, I don't know what he did. His name was Mr. Grunewald, that's all I know. And he used to go on trips and come back with little gifts for us because, you know, we didn't have very much.
It was a tough neighborhood. It was divided up into gangs. The avenues had gangs, the streets were free passages. I was in the gangs all of my childhood until I went to high school. But I had a teacher who thought I was talented, and I had painted several murals for the school, and she thought it was a shame that I wasn't going to this new high school at May LaGuardia. Had just started a high school of music and art, which later became very famous as this fame school and all that. Well, I passed the test with flying colors, but my academics were bad, and my speech was such that unless you came from the same area of the Bronx, you couldn't understand a word I said.
And I was very proud that Harry got a scholarship. I couldn't imagine anybody getting one, you know, because that was, well, it's just wonderful, I thought, and I admired him for it. I used to think he was a genius, actually.
When I graduated, they gave awards for the best artist in the class, best musician, and I got the best sculptor in the class. In graduating from the High School of Music and Art, I got a free scholarship to the Beaux-Arts Institute of Design. Almost all the successful sculptors in the United States would take turns teaching there. You spent a year copying plaster molds. And then when they decided that you were good enough, you could work from the live model. And the model had to take the same pose and they rotated it. And you worked about three-quarter size. You had to do every muscle, everything right. You had to have all your proportions right. You were like a camera. You were replicating what you saw. And the closer you came to that, the better the piece of work, no matter how ugly it looked. And then when you were all done at the end, you take pictures of it, and then you break it all up, throw it in the clay bar, start on the next model. At the end of every year, they chose the most successful student to get a Tiffany grant. That was the top award for the class. Usually you're there 6 to 10 years before you win a prize. And I got the first prize, that's 2 years. I ended up doing a life-size figure out of clay of this woman who was posing. I had no idea what the Tiffany thing was. All I knew was that all my expenses would be paid for a summer out on Long Island doing sculpture. Right at that moment, the war had begun and the draft had begun, and I was bound to be coming up. I was just 21. I was drafted at Grand Central in New York. I was going down answering a letter saying that I would report at this time. And I said goodbye to my parents thinking, well, I might see you tonight or tomorrow. I don't know. I never saw him. In my case, I was going into the Air Force. I drew all the time, and it was another way of expressing myself. I set up a little drawing table, and I do portraits of guys in the barracks, portraits of their girlfriend from photograph, anything. And then it led into doing jackets.
Thank you.
sort of a tradition among the flying boys to put the names of their girlfriends or the name of their plane on the back of their jackets. Also, it was a way of showing how many missions they went on. Each bomb stenciled on their jacket represented a mission. And each time they showed a SWAT sticker, it meant the plane was shot down by them. And it was a way of showing off their record. When I got home, I went down the village and I realized that all the excitement was happening down there. And everywhere you went, there were ex-GIs walking the streets full of vim and vigor and wanting to do exciting things. So I registered at the Art Students League, and I signed up in the class with Zadkin, and I signed up with Zorak, another sculptor, and with Jose de Kraft, who taught there. I was feeling pretty hot, like I'm a pretty big shot now. I would strut around town and covered with dust from stone carving, charming all the girls in the class, and just having a wild time. De Kraft, whom I liked best of all the teachers, said, look, go to Black Mountain College, where he had taught. It's a wild place, it's a place for an artist to experiment, and you'd enjoy it there. I said, but I have no connections, how can I get in? He just got on the phone, called up, told him that I was a perfect student to go there, and they said, send him along. So I shipped my trunk out, got on a train, and went to Black Mountain College, North Carolina. I arrived there in the spring and had the first summer I spent there. It was just fantastic. I never was to a college where there was so much serious work going on, hard working without being driven by tests or anything like that. And they had the most interesting faculty. They had faculty that didn't get along in regular colleges because they were too progressive. And, you know, everybody went there that became important in the art field. Rauschenberg, Merce Cunningham. You just go down the list. All the contemporary artists in dancing and music and art went there. In the fall session, a whole new batch of students would come in. Somebody yelled, hey, Harry, there's a girl here whose father is a sculptor. And I said, oh yeah, who's that? And that was Mirand.
At Black Mountain, I met Harry the second year I was there. And he was, I thought, very handsome.
And her father was Arnold Geisbühler. And so I said hi to her, and it was a very casual meeting.
And my father had been an apprentice to Bourdel, who was a sculptor, and he had been, in turn, an apprentice to Rodin. Anyway, one day I was sitting in my study and heard the steps running down the hall, and it was Harry, and he stopped, like, because he saw a drawing of my father's that I had on my desk. I could understand him because he was a sculptor. Surely a sculptor at that time.
And I started to go steady with it for the remainder of the time at Black Mountain College.
You know, I figured from the very beginning that this was a soulmate, that I was going to marry this man.
As I can remember, we were always drawing and Tina making masks, you know, out of paper mache. I think we just, it just was part of who we were growing up.
The girls were very artistic, and they drew all over the furniture and the walls and the floor. I mean, everywhere I had paper, I encouraged them. I loved having children, and he was a very good father. He, you know, just lots and lots of fun for them.
I was full of enthusiasm, full of energy, and I could see progress, and I enjoyed the work, and the idea that I could just sit down on a wheel and make anything I wanted. And the challenges of getting bigger and nicer shapes. My beginning years of work I produced was very much influenced by Hamada's Japanese pottery. It was earthy, it was a little on the primitive side, it was heavier, and the colors were limited to browns, whites, and blacks, and weren't very bright except for oxblood red, which I managed to get. And the decoration was very spontaneous and plain brushwork and splashing. It's almost as if an amateur Hamada had taken over. I was teaching school in Chatham, and this elderly woman came up and said she'd like me to come and visit her husband, who is very depressed because he's just recently gone blind. So I went to the house, and you could see the frustration he had in not being able to use himself. So I asked him if he'd like to try it, and I said I'd have to find out how to go about teaching it. Back at the shop, I would put a thing over my eyes, and then I would discover what the problems were, the throwing. I learned how to center the clay by slapping and kicking the wheel, letting the wheel go very slowly, the center, how to figure out where the clay was, where the water was, keeping my sponge in a certain place, keeping my cutoff string in one place, so that to this day I work that way. Every time I put the string down, I put it in the same place. Every time I put the rib down, I put it in the same place. So I know where everything is. I don't have to think. My hand goes to that spot instantly. The rest is all feel, which he loved. And he got good at it in no time. He was making bowls and pots and vases. The question was that the thing, when the things come out of the kiln, and I told him, well, this is a beautiful glaze, he couldn't see the color. So he could only feel texture. He says, well, I don't like the blue or red glaze. I would like to have some bumps or something on the surface, something I could feel. So I said, yeah, well, press it out and shape the walls while it's soft. And he did. He started pressing it out. And then he fired the pots. And he didn't care about glazing. He just liked to make these shapes with bumps sticking out. And it felt good to him to put his hand over it when it was all done. I got influence from him, and I started to do what I call sculpted pots. The first thing you know, because I'm very figurative, I was doing figures on the side, and sometimes abstract shapes. In the early days, there was more or less a relief on the walls of the pot. But later on, the whole pot took on the shape of a piece of sculpture as I got more skillful at pressing it out. I never added any clay, never took any away. I just stretched the clay like a repoussé, and with a rib on the outside, I kept pushing the clay and pushing it as far as I could get it to go without it collapsing. Pressing out these forms became very feminine forms for me. Breasts and buttocks and sort of a baroque cherub-like figures bursting out of the surface.
The thing that amazes me the most about Harry is he's constantly producing work, and he seems to always be really interested in having new ideas all the time. Even today, I mean, he's still, you know, coming up with these new pieces over and over again, new ideas all the time. It's amazing.
I had never in my wildest imaginations thought that pieces that were so incredibly detailed and complex could be created with clay. You can explore the whole world of architecture through clay. That had never entered my mind, and it was so much fun to find out where that inspiration came from him, He said it came from his kids, that he would give his kids clay and they were making castles.
I think he's always being influenced by movies and other artists, his own daughters. I think he draws off of his surroundings. He's very influenced by the relationships he's in. He's done a lot of things relating to the beach in his work, maybe abstract paintings that are ocean-like or water-like. He's also an abstract expressionist, I would say, as an artist. Very influenced by that period of art. I think that's his favorite period in art. He's very influenced by Picasso and the cubists. I think his work is very cubistic, his paintings are, his clay work oftentimes is. He was also trained by José de Kreft as a sculptor, and I think that comes through his work a lot, his sculptural ideas. His forms are always voluminous. They're very sculptural.